that one's forward. Okay. Disclosures really is just that we use a human formulation of the ketogenic diet called KetoCal. It's donated to us. That's the only disclosure I have. So the very first thing we did when we started getting into the ketogenic diet is we tried this in vitro. We used a cell line named AO2V4, here it is, which was a cell line that was derived from the fourth brain tumor that a young man had. Very, very aggressive tumor. This guy was treated with everything there was to be treated with back in the 70s, I believe, and it makes any growth factor they knew to look for. It was grown in 28 millimolar glucose, so that's very high glucose. That's what the media had. And what we did was we just, without reducing glucose, we threw in 5 millimolar each beta-hydroxybutyrate and acetoacetate. And we also tried one of the drugs that this patient was treated with, which is, actually, I don't have to stand there, here, which is BCNUocarmistine. That was actually the drug of choice for brain tumors at the time. And what you can see is the cells that are mock-treated grow very nicely. The cells treated with BCNU, they lag and then they start to grow. That's normal when you treat cells in vitro with chemotherapy like that. The ketones, without reducing glucose, inhibited the growth or slowed it, but the two together wiped the culture out. And frankly, that was the first experiments that we did that made me decide to change the entire direction of my lab to the ketogenic diet. Because my thought was, the ketogenic diet or anything else was pretty much useless unless it was done in combination with standard of care because no clinician would ever use it. So we had to come up with a mouse model at the time. We were doing that. We got the gene that's in fireflies, put it in a mouse glioma cell line called GL261. They now glow, and now we can follow the mouse tumor. So this is the GL261 LUC2 model. We use albino C57 black 6 mice, syngeneic, immunocompetent. We give them KetoCal. It's a powder. We mix it 2-to-1 as a paste. We throw it in the cage. They can eat as much as they want. They roll in it. They get a little greasy, but it doesn't seem to bother them. They don't, and they're women, so it doesn't seem to bother them. They're female mice. We don't inhibit, we don't do any caloric restriction. They can eat whatever they want. They don't tend to lose weight, and they don't tend to gain weight beyond the animals that are on standard diet. This has all been published, which is why I'm going through it really fast. Okay, so the animals get surgery on day zero. The tumor cells are intracranially implanted. On the third day, they are scanned, randomized to a treatment arm. We test BHB and glucose levels, and the animals are sacrificed when symptoms appear. Symptoms appear in this model reproducibly about 24 hours before they're going to die. So I'm an animal lover. I do not intend to let animals suffer. We can do in vivo imaging to follow the growth of the tumor. And this is what we found. These are what I'm going to show you in the next couple slides is a combination of two totally separate experiments. So standard diet survival, KetoCal survival. So there is an increase in survival. When you add temozolomide, which is the chemotherapy of choice for brain tumors now, survival is better, standard diet with chemotherapy, than it was standard diet alone. But the KetoCal makes that better. But this was what blew our minds and started to get patients calling on me. And that might be okay for you clinicians, but as a scientist, when a patient calls you, it's a little bit interesting. Because all I could tell him is, well, I can tell you what helps our mice, you know. So anyway, this is whole brain radiation, and the radiated animals do better than the standard diet alone. But when we added KetoCal, basically we cured 9 of 11 mice. And the reason we know that this happened is we can follow the growth of the tumor. This is just one of the animals. And here's one of the animals that was on ketogenic diet. I don't know how well you can see it in the back, but this is a very, very bright tumor cell line. The tumor was there. It starts to disappear. It comes up a little bit. But by around day 40, all of the mice, you could not see anything. And this is published work, and it's in open access journals, so feel free to look at it. Right around day 101, I decided that rather than continue to chew our budget to have these little ladies running around their cage happy, let's switch them back to standard diet and see what happens. And we did that for another 200 days, and the tumors didn't come back. And the pathologist said there was no evidence of any active tumor in these animals when they were sacrificed. So we were unbelievably excited about this. It does not mean we think we can cure humans, but in the very least, this was a step forward. And this really kind of charged us up for looking more specifically at radiation plus ketogenic diet. One of the things we found in our very first experiment was that it reduces ROS. And we found this using a different technique where we could only look at one time point and it was late. And I'm thinking, okay, this stuff makes radiation work better, but radiation works through ROS. This makes no sense. Let's find another way to look at ROS. Maybe the ROS goes up early and then it comes down. So we did. We used this L012 chemiluminescence, and the closest we could come to looking was 24 hours. But at every time point, the ketogenic diet reduces ROS. So for years, I'd stand up, give a talk, and say, if anyone in the audience understands this, please come talk to me, because we don't. But we do now, we think. The other thing that we think helps is it does reduce inflammation based on looking at cyclooxygenase 2. All the other speakers in the past that mentioned anything about inflammation said it did reduce inflammation. I've got some pretty tall shoulders to stand on with the previous speakers. So you can see ketocal reduces the COX-2. Radiation, it goes up, as you would expect, but the animals on ketocal, it holds that COX-2 from going up after radiation. So we really think that in addition to helping the radiation work better, it might actually do a lot of things that would help a patient. Okay, so things I don't have time to talk about is the pluripotent nature of ketogenic diet is unbelievable. When I first started, I thought it was snake oil. I didn't believe it, to be perfectly honest. It inhibits tumor growth. It enhances radiation, and at least some of the chemotherapies that we've looked at, and others, of course, are showing other chemotherapies are also made to work better. We've published this. It reduces peritumoral edema. It reduces inflammation. It reduces angiogenesis. It reduces hypoxia. It reduces the expression of HIF-1 alpha and phosphorylated NF-kappa B, and it increases the anti-tumor immune response. So we decided to focus on the radiation, and one of the things we have to do is say, okay, we have to go back to the in vitro models and see, can we recapitulate it so we can start to tease apart what's happening? And it turns out that indeed we can. These are the mouse cells. We used a low amount of radiation, which is 2 gray, inhibits growth. Low amount of beta-hydroxybutyrate, 2 millimolar, not really enough to inhibit growth, but the two together absolutely work better. This is a human cell line. That's not the patient's initials. It's a random two-letter code, and this is a recurrent tumor, so we add an R to the end. So this is a human cell line. Again, these are grown in high glucose. I'm taking glucose totally out of the picture for the purposes of what we're saying. And again, this green line is what's important. Ketones plus radiation, better than either alone. So the mechanisms of action of the ketones beyond glucose reduction, we think it has to do with epigenetic modifications. So everything I've shown you up to this point has been published. All of this now has not been published. My grad student just got his PhD last month and had his first baby and moved to North Carolina. So we're finishing up some of those studies and looking to publish hopefully a little later this year. But the epigenetic effects of the ketogenic diet that's been shown by others are changes in histoneacetylation. Beta-hydroxybutyrate is an HDAC inhibitor, as you've heard before by some very elegant talks in this meeting. There are changes in the non-coding RNAs, specifically alterations in microRNAs. And then there's also probably alterations in DNA methylation, which I won't actually get a chance to tell you about. So for any of you who are not biochemists, I'm certainly not, which is why I need nice, easy cartoons. When DNA is deacetylated, it's closed. I think in cartoons, I think of DNA like this, and the radiation can't hit it, okay? When it's open and it's acetylated, now there's lots of space, radiation and chemo can damage it. So acetylation, histone-acetylases go that way, deacetylases go that way, and BHB blocks that. So that's what you want in a cancer cell. So there's lots of a number of HDAC inhibitors that are actually in clinical trials. As most therapies, they have various side effects. But what's interesting is a lot of times the histone deacetylases, they act differently in tumor cells than normal cells, and that really follows what we see with BHB. So first we decided to look at, does BHB increase histone acetylation in our model? And indeed it does. So this is just a Western blot for acetylated histone 3 K1914, and you can see this is without radiation. This is with radiation. In the presence of BHB, you do get an increase in acetylation, as you would expect. And that's enhanced even a little bit more when you add radiation into the mix. This is in our mouse cell line. This is in a glioblastoma cell line. Again, ME is not the patient's initials. It's a random two-letter code. This is the primary tumor that goes along with the cells I showed you before, which is the recurrent tumor from the same patient. So these cells are from the patient before they were treated. Again, BHB increases histoneacetylation in these cells as well. Okay, so what about DNA damage? Gamma H2AX is a marker for DNA damage. It sticks to the end of damaged DNA, and it basically tells everybody else, okay, come here, guys, we need you to repair this. So the more gamma H2AX there is, the more damaged DNA there is. As the DNA is repaired, the gamma H2AX goes down. So you can see it's kind of low in the absence of radiation, and the BHB doesn't really make a difference. Radiation damages the DNA. BHB, there is more damage. So what's happening, we think, is the BHB is actually inhibiting DNA damage repair. Oops, sorry, wrong one. Again, the mouse cells, the human cells, it's even more pronounced in the human cells where there's very little gamma H2AX, very little damaged DNA before radiation. After radiation, there's quite a bit, and it's increased in the presence of BHB. What about glioma stem cells? Glioma stem cells are thought to be cells in the glioma, or they should say stem-like cells, are thought to be cells in the glioma that are more resistant to radiation, more resistant to chemo, probably reside in a hypoxic area of the tumor. And one of the thoughts is that these cells kind of repopulate the tumor after treatment, although that's up for a lot of discussion, which we can get into later. But we did have a talented high school student in my lab that actually looked at glioma stem cells, and these cells were very kindly provided by Dr. Brent Reynolds from Florida. So on day zero, she seeded the cells. On day one, we treated them with beta-hydroxybutyrate. The next day, they got 4 gray of radiation. And then 7 days later, the neurospheres were dissociated and counted. So this is one of the cell lines, L0, and just looking at live cell count. So beta-hydroxybutyrate does inhibit. Radiation inhibits, but the two together inhibit better. So beta-hydroxybutyrate is also enhancing the effect of radiation on glioma stem cells. Oops, sorry. It is hard with two different buttons. So here's the second glioma stem cell line from a different patient. And again, the magnitude is just slightly different, but the effect is the same. The beta-hydroxybutyrate does enhance the effect of radiation in glioma stem-like cells, as well as human glioma cells and mouse glioma cells. Here we're looking at DNA damage, again, using gamma H2AX. And in the presence of beta-hydroxybutyrate, we do see a little bit of an increase. But with radiation, there's a big increase. And the acetylation goes up, too. Another marker, no, it's not a marker, but another protein that's involved in DNA damage repair. So this is looking at, is there DNA damage? And this is looking at one of the proteins involved in the repair of that damage. So more of this is more damage. Less of this is less repair of damage. So when you look at RAD51, again, in these glioma stem cells, it's definitely down in the presence of BHB. So looking at all the cell lines I've been talking about so far, this is our mouse glioma cell line. This is our human glioblastoma cell line. This is the recurrent tumor cell line from this patient. So in other words, these cells are the tumor that came back after radiation and temozolomide treatment. And this is that first cell line I told you about, which is extremely aggressive, came from the fourth tumor that this young man had. So in all cases, the RAD51 is reduced, and the acetylation is increased. MER wasn't quite statistically significant, but it approached significance. So essentially, what we think is happening in radiation, because I said we were really confused about that whole ROS thing, is we think that we might not be increasing the DNA damage through ROS, but we're probably reducing the DNA damage repair. And that also kind of makes sense with how it seems to help some of the alkylating agents, is that we think that the epigenetic effect is actually causing a reduction in the genes that are involved in DNA damage repair. And we actually have data that some of the other proteins involved in DNA damage repair are also reduced. So now to switch gears a little bit to microRNAs. MicroRNAs are small non-coding RNAs. They're about 22 nucleotides long, so they're little itty-bitty things. They're involved in RNA silencing through a variety of mechanisms. And one microRNA species, they're kind of promiscuous, and it can actually reduce the expression of a number of microRNAs. A number of proteins. But the repression usually isn't extreme. But they're still pretty active. In fact, some people are actually looking at these as potential therapeutic agents. So in collaboration with an excellent researcher, Dr. Nell Syed, at the Imperial College in the UK, we sent her tumor tissue from our mice, and she did an RNA-seq analysis of all microRNAs, and she came up with a whole bunch of microRNAs that are differentially expressed. When the microRNAs are up, the proteins that they affect are down. Okay, so up means we're turning down proteins. And there's just a whole bunch of them. And quite a few of these are involved in DNA damage repair, interestingly enough. But what's really interesting is when I think of metabolism, I think, well, most of them kind of should be metabolism or maybe epigenetic stuff. Turns out if you look at the hallmarks of cancer, pretty much every hallmark of cancer is affected. And this is the only difference here. This one, I'm guessing, will be when they figure out more microRNAs that are involved in genome instability. So when you think about it, we all think of metabolism, well, I guess not in this room, but most rooms, when often talking, they think of metabolism as, okay, it's the food, it's the energy, it's the glucose, it's all that stuff. Well, in fact, it's a whole lot more. Metabolism is going to hit every single hallmark, and it's going to change gene expression pretty much in every single hallmark. So, summarize, ketone-induced epigenetic changes, BHB is an HDAC inhibitor that's been shown by others. It increases histoneacetylation in our tumors. This, we think, causes a decrease in genes that encode the DNA repair proteins, so we get an increase in the radiation-induced DNA damage, and we think that's how it's potentiating radiation. We do get the increased expression of about 55 different microRNAs, and again, that's the work of Dr. Nell Syed. That's from tumor tissue. We are working on this in cell lines, and she's working on it in cell lines. We're showing that changing the microRNA does indeed change the expression of some of these genes, including the DNA repair genes. We've got some very exciting information. One of the microRNAs that we know is involved in changing c-MYC, which is really interesting because I just very recently moved to Phoenix Children's Hospital. And now I'm kind of turning most of my work towards pediatric tumors, so of course we're really interested in that. And there's also some data that I don't have time to talk about, we've got just very little of it, that suggests that BHB and the KD might actually also affect gene methylation. I'd like to acknowledge the people who do this work. Again, Nell in the UK, we had immunologists that were working on the immunology project, various other people that work with me. Eric Wolf was my grad student who just got his PhD. Alex was a high school student, now a college student, and now actually working as my technician, which is great because he's totally trained. Lena, by me, so all of his bad habits are good habits I know about. Lena did the glioma stem cell work as a high school student. She's now in Stanford with more scholarship money than I can ever hope to get for my research. And then there are other people that were in the lab that have contributed to all of this. Acknowledgements, as you all know, when you write to the NIH for funding, diet is a four-letter word. Luckily, there are other foundations and people that have helped fund this, and we're hoping that now that Dr. Cantley has jumped on board, diet will no longer be a four-letter word. But I've been very fortunate in getting people that have been willing to fund some of this work, and questions will come later. So thank you.